Okay, so for any good project, you start have to. No, for any good project that's creative, you should start. For any good creative project, you should first start with good research. So here I found a ship design that has not existed in real life, but it's kind of an imaginary design based on an. I think it was a study that was made at the time where they designed the Alsace class for France. So I decided I want to use this hull, so I'm going to save the image in a place where I can find it. And my spot happens to be in. I'm sorry. I have a bug on my computer, on my mouse right now, that is making all of the stuff scroll down. So Blender, and let's just save it here. Okay, save it. So my folder in Blender. You'll want to press 3 to do this profile view, and then I will choose the image that I had here and just drag it in. And then I would place it. I think if I go in edit mode, then I would place it exactly where I want it to be, dragging out the corners. Now I'm not don't necessarily care about the size for right now, because all I want to do is place it and just block out a general view. Another thing you'll want to do is grab it and bring it back here, and then place another version. So if I do Shift D, hit X, and then rotate 90 degrees, that'll be probably negative on the Y axis. Yeah. Then we'll have it vertically. So press 7 to go vertically. And then I would like to adjust it a little bit so that it's as straight as possible. Then you'd have a view that's on the side. And you'd have a view from the top, right? Ideally, you will need to have at least a side view and a top view to make pretty much any model. Ideally, you would also have a front view, back view, something of that sort, and also something that could give you reference to what the object might look like versus a plan. I think it doesn't matter if you're being creative, but at least it helps when the plan is precise, because you'll I've already had the experience of copying a whole ship and then realizing that the plan is kind of off. By using another plan, it was far more accurate, but I also had to change everything, and the position of every single object in the whole thing changes. What we do is start with a cube, and I'll want to make it so that it's about the height of the deck. So I'll go in wireframe view, because I think that's the right height. But then I'll select it down, and then hit A. Scale on the y-axis, so we're going to stretch it out so that it's just a long rectangle. Fits along the height, and then be more accurate along the bow, for example, and then grab Z to go at that height and fit it pretty perfectly. And if ever it happens that you want to straighten something to align with each other, I do R for loop cut, and then you can do Shift Tab, or you can just hit this. Set the snapping to vertex. So then I grab on the z-axis and snap to the vertex that I want to align to. And that gives two parts that are perfectly straight. So I'll do Alsace study. Sorry, I just saved automatically as an afterthought. So let's go in the top-down view, and this is where the fun begins. Now I might want to deactivate snapping for this. First, we're going to delete this side because we won't need it anymore. And then we're going to mirror. Our mirror is here. Okay. And x-axis is good, and we want to include clipping. That means that vertices won't go across each other. So I cannot grab this past the point. And then you can start adjusting. So you see how it's helpful to have images that match exactly. Even this one that looked precise is not quite correct when we compare the bow, but I'll refer to this on the top side. So then I will just start to very roughly portray what the ship would look like. The reason I can do this is that we will add the subsurface modifier, and that enables you to work with the very simplified geometry. And the trick here is to always work with the simplest geometry you can. I've often, it's been a few quite a few times I've done this with airplanes and boats and so on, and even houses. And what I've come to realize is that it's very easy to want to add details in, and but you first need to add the very basic geometry for things to work out well. I will try to align vertices along noticeable parts of the object. And for the most part, it's just getting a very basic shape. So then I can go down here. Also, I like to have, as much as I can, I like to have vertices aligned to one another. For example, this one is going horizontally across, and that helps keep the geometry a lot cleaner, especially if you're going to do, for example, I like doing 3D printing. That helps a lot with that. And I won't detail too much, I just know that I will need to have, so I do Control R for loop cut, and I will need to have a loop cut here. If ever is here, vertices are not aligning at all, you do Shift and then go in the direction you want to align it, so in this case Y, and when you scale inwards, in one direction only, you're able to scale so that the scale reduces to zero, and then the vertices align with each other. In this case, I'm aligning it with the bottom of the keel here. And let's just fix the alignment of this. And then I said that I would rely on the top for the ends of the ship, so that's fine. Is there anything else? Oh yeah, we'll want to place this one outside here. Alright, now that I've done that, we can add our modifier. So we have a very basic ship hull design, right? I notice I haven't done anything else to it. I haven't kind of like adjusted the vertices on the side, which is why a plan with a front view and a back view would be extremely useful. But here we're going to add a subsurface modifier. And with those subdivisions, you'll see it'll ruin your thing, but it doesn't matter for right now. What you want to do is select the vertices. You do select and then control. If you hold control, it'll select all the vertices that are in a line. And then you do shift E, and all of a sudden you have a very beautiful curve, right? Then we probably want to go along the bow and add a couple of, well, for now, might just sort to making this a hard edge. However, it won't really help because there's no geometry that's aiding in controlling where the bow goes. So if we add another set of vertices, if I hit GG, it'll move along the edge. Right. This will make the bow more pointy, but we do need extra geometry for making the shape of the bow. So as you can see, when I add geometry, then it brings the shape forward. So if I go back in wireframe view, this is the problem with adding more details at first, right? Because then you're caught realigning your mesh along the spots you don't want to do. So instead of doing that, we want to make sure, first of all, that all the vertices are in place that allow us to make the shapes that we need. Here, I'll do again the same trick, scale Y. That'll bring all the vertices scaled and at the right distance. And then we're going to fit this. I can see the actual curve of the geometry is here. So I might want to move this, I guess it would be forward. And this will be adjusted later on, of course. I do not want to go lower than this, so it seems like that was the correct height. Okay, and then I think I'm ready to add something down the middle, so let's do that. Okay, we're going to scale along the z-axis, keep everything nice and flat. Okay, now I can grab along the z-axis and align it, I guess, along the bottom of the waterline. Here. And now we can see our geometry is wrong. So to fix that, I will need to move the geometry along the edges, and it does require some amount of thought. But what I want to first do is place this geometry correctly. Usually the bat will have a more slanted appearance. And from the bottom, it will be a lot closer to itself. Sorry. Remember, it's shift tab to remove or add the snapping. Okay. Something like this would be the shape. And then the hull would be roughly flat at the bottom. Now, it looks like, if ever I wanted to tighten this, I would just add another loop cut here. Of course, as I say, loop cuts dirty your geometry, so I'm waiting a little bit on that. I will bring this a little closer. Yeah, we will need to eventually have geometry here that will control this. But I just want to block everything out for now. So along this edge can be a more complex task. Usually what happens is that if you create a an extra element of geometry along the bow, you'll have something that comes here. So let me just refine the shape of the hull first. I want to add a loop cut here. I can see my line, my median line here. Yeah, so this one is incorrect because we placed it from the side. Place it from the top. Looks like there's a slight, I don't know if we call it maybe a bulge there. Still line. Of course, the more you add geometry, the more you add work. So try to add the least possible, but at the same time, you do have to adjust along the lines that you need. Okay. Here we go. I'll add it at the bow. And we can see we have a beautiful curve, and it's just created by a few vertices. And as you play with them, you'll get a more or less exact curve because of the smoothing that's occurring in the background. I don't think I need to be too fussy with that right now. I'm going to go roughly like this. Then at the back, we have the same issue, but now I added geometry. So I will be able to adjust where the curve goes, and I'm still following that line here. I do believe I need to move this out and have an extra loop cut down here somewhere. I'm putting it in just the middle for now. And there we have our curve. Now I can bring this in a little bit more. Okay, so now we have our exact shape pretty much. And then we come to forming the hull. You can already see that we have the hull bending outwards as we want it. I want to take care of the stern, so for this, I'll first start by moving, well, yeah, we don't quite have enough geometry to do this correctly. Let me just get a reference photo. So I want a bow on reference photo, and I believe that I wouldn't have one of this ship exactly, but we might have something similar. So this is SS. This is the same class of ship, so I'll save the image as well. And then in here, front view is control 1. You can see control 1. Alright, so let's drag this one in. And now we have to kind of fit it to the geometry that we're making. G to move, S for scaling. And unfortunately, this doesn't scale exactly where we would want it to because it depends on where we placed it and not where the exact spot in the picture is, but you can get a rough idea of the scale here. I'm sorry. Alright, and now I can drag the handles to make it a bit easier on myself. Should have the width. As you can see, it's not the exact same ship, but it should give us a rough estimate of what the profile would be. Okay. So that was tedious, but that works. So as I can see right now, I can tell that my profile is a little bit, excuse me, I'm going to grab everything, move it inwards. I'm not sure that's the best technique. I think that will work. Yeah. And we can see the bow is pretty much the same. Okay. So that looks pretty good. So that means that our contours were already quite nice, that a battleship is quite flat. You want to see everything smoothly? You can just do shade smooth. And then... okay. Along here, towards the back, we don't really see it in the pictures, but there is a reduction in size. So we do need extra geometry right here. That means that if our geometry is placed right now, it'll have the correct space. I do remember we were going to fit this more exactly. This would be a good time to do that as well. If I do grab Y, maybe. If I do GG, goes along this same axis. And then each new design is a new discovery process, I'd say. It could be that it would be beneficial for me to move this downwards, but as we're adding geometry, it keeps getting more accurate. Also, one thing that can be done, is adding a bit of geometry here to create the very front profile of the bow. When these two vertices are very close together, they become very pointy, but you want something that's relatively mild at the front. Yeah. Something like this would work out quite well. And then the wider you place them, like if I hit GG and I go here, it just allows you to control the curve a little better. And then at the bottom, you'd be able to mark these vertices as straighter. So if I go here and hit Shift E, right, these would be flat, and then we'd have that sort of shape that we see in the image, where part of it is going upwards and the rest is going flat against the front. And then you could scale that down to an appropriate plate size, but I won't bore you with the details. Okay, on this end here, we can see I had placed already an element that's about here. That's the keel, the bottom of the keel. The boat does not go... oh, I don't see where my... I'm used to the vertex mode. Okay, so the boat does not go exactly flat. That means that these things here are going upwards, and we have to try to follow the shadow that has been indicated for us in this image. If I just grab it and move it up, that should be roughly accurate. That just has the disadvantage that this, at this point, it's going to move our the vertices off from the waterline, which won't make everything flat. But my point is that the keel here would be brought together like this, and then you'd have a similar situation where you would probably want to bring, I believe, these vertices at the back. Instead of having them where they don't belong, you would bring them at the same level as these, scale them in, have that shape being developed again. Now this here would be, once again, edge creased. And then this would be moved roughly based on our needs. So you can see that everything has an influence. Now I just need to remove my snapping. I'm wondering if it would be possible to, because the back is curved, I would need to add more geometry. So I will leave it like this for now. But of course it does curve slightly inwards, so we're not getting the exact fit, but you know what, I'm not too concerned at this moment. We would need to add another set of geometries right there. Now in the solid view, you can see where things go wrong and start correcting them. So right now what we've done has moved a few vertices close together that shouldn't be. They should kind of be diagonal. So you'd place them along these lines here. And this one would go higher. Yep. Then you'd have a nice stern ending. And here, move it to where you have a round stern, as in the photograph. Okay? What I like to do, and this should be a default, you can kind of see that the edges here are being smoothed out. You go into normals and do auto smooth, and you can control the degrees at which the smooth happens. 30 degrees is about right for a lot of things, but you might want to correct it to be a bit more than that. And there we go. We have an SS ship. Now, I am realizing that the superstructure would not have a seam on this. So it would, I would tend to model it as being part of the whole ship itself. Because if you were, for instance, to print this out, then you'd want the superstructure to fit exactly with the edges of the hull. To be able to do this, that means we will need to add loop cuts exactly where the superstructure meets. There are a couple of ways that we could go around doing this. And one thing that might be appropriate at this stage is deleting the extra vertices that are at the top. Because we don't need all those vertices to act as a continuum, we just need them for the hull. So I might go in my line selection tool and hit subdivide, then select this one and bring that along the y-axis to where I think this should go. And then I do the same thing here, subdivide, and bring this along the y-axis where it would go. Then remember control click, and then E for extrude, Z to maintain, and there we have it. We have an edge that can be used for starting the end of the hull, and we'd want this to be smooth, so shifty again, unsmooth it. Now you'll notice these pieces are appearing, and that's because we don't have a corner. Here it looks convenient, but actually you'd probably need to have a second layer. So let me just show how I would do that. I would take this, representing the thickness of the wall, extrude inwards. Why won't it let me extrude inwards? Extrude X. Make sure that this is completely edge hardened, and then I would move this as close as possible. Then this top part also needs to be made Blade Sharp. Ooh, I forgot something. Forgot to select this one. Okay. Do that. E, X, X. That. And then if I go in solid view, it might be a little better to select this top part. Can shift E for making the edges. Okay. Now along this edge, I would leave this corner to be smoothed out, right? Because this edge along the bottom is not selected. This would require that the rest have this sort of extrusion. So again, I think it's a matter of doing details before the actual shape of the model has taken place. Because if I go back, delete, having a hard time telling what's actually getting deleted. Solid wire. This was the original. If we select this face and this face and actually do the shape of it, we would extrude, probably not bring them together because there are round turrets here. So then I'd grab this and go place it right along, switch. It seems is not exactly where the image is telling us on this edge, which is very strange and suspicious. Yeah, so you can see here's the need for having accurate images right here. Here is telling me that the edge of that shape, the superstructure, is here, but here is telling me it's farther back. What I'll need to do to correct that is trust one or the other drawing, which is not super convenient. If I go along this edge and I realize that it fits along that corner, was it that set of vertices? Or roughly here, and then this one, I don't know exactly where it would end, but I imagine that it goes along the curve from the turret. Then, this same thing at the back. And I imagine the turrets are the same width, so I'd seek to align them. So I do grab X, and then turn that off, and then grab Y, and then place it. It doesn't look aligned, but I know I already aligned it with the other one, so I'm assuming that's an inaccuracy with the plan. And then here again. Turns out that was not accurate. Now I can hit GG, and that'll move it, well, in this case, it wants to move it along the wrong axis, so I'll have to do simple G for grab. There. Alright. Now we got the shape. It's going to look very weird because we just need to sharpen the edges along here. Sharpen the edges along here. And... oh. The edge is not connected. How nice. That means the edge is going inwards. So to fix that, I'll just delete this vertex I don't need, and I do not want this here. I don't know what that's. Vertices is going to delete everything. F to join. That was the source of our problems before, but yeah, now we have a correct shape. Now I might want to add the circular layout of the turrets. Do this because I'm assuming the turrets, yeah, the circular, that's the citadel, is placed below the turret, and then this little ledge here. So I'll choose a circle, and so, yeah, here in the add circle menu, I don't want it to have many vertices. Let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, would be good, I think. Maybe more like 10. 12. That looks respectable. Now if I grab Y, bring that up here. Tab. Scale. I want to fit this exactly along these corners. So I'm going to do grab Y. Scale that out a little bit. That looks correct. And then tab again. Grab Z. And then extrude Z. So now it looks like they fit exactly. They won't be ultra precise, but what I'll do is simply cheat. So I'll grab this and then grab X. We'll bring them together. Then what we want to do is join these together. So I'll do join. Then, we have problems. So it's causing an issue with the modifier. Maybe if I select the inverse first. Which one did I select first? Okay, there we go. And now we want to make sure that these vertices are together. So to do that, we do Control A to select all. Do merge by distance, and then you'll see that this vertex and that vertex are the same. And we'll go in this view. We'll want to make sure to have the top of this covered, and then it's going to look weird. So we do Shift E to flatten everything out, and then we would do the same thing at the front. Looks like. Like the order of the modifiers is not perfect here because the mirror is causing a problem. I don't know if I place it the other way. Oh, there we go. So what I did is just put the subdivision modifier on top of the mirror modifier. And that way, in that order, they look correct. We do want the seam here. And now we can adjust what size it is. The only problem is, at this point, when we adjust the size, we're going to adjust the size in all directions. So that means that the height will be incorrect. So if I do grab Y, adjust the location a little bit, and then scale, that means our scale is upsetting the vertical scale as well. So to fix that, just grab this, make sure we're on snapping mode, snap it to the top, grab that, snap it to the bottom. There we go. Now, so you wanted to get that out of the way, just do grab Y. Just lets us see the front. And yeah, then we want to do this at the front of the ship. So what I can do here, I think the easiest way would just be to duplicate the whole thing. And if I do right-click, it's going to cancel the snapping. Grab on the Y-axis. Place it there. Select invert, delete all the vertices, so now we're left with that same shape. We don't need the modifiers. Now I'll just try to place it as before. Grab Y. This is roughly right. Yeah, this is fine. And then what we'll want to do, I think it's select the ship. If I'm not mistaken, join, nope, wrong way, join, and then we know that it's exactly the same size. All we want to do is follow the same process, this one here, just select that edge, grab X, grab Y, merge by distance, and there we go. We have that part. So now we can just delete the back. I don't really need this. Same thing here. You can hit Control if you want to do it all at once. All right. And now we probably just floor it so that this bit here has a floor, this bit here has a floor, and then I'd also want my vertices to align, grab X, and there we go. And now all you'd have to do to complete everything, this is the, this is what happens with the order of the modifiers being wrong. And then, it does seem strange to me that the clipping didn't prevent us from doing something like this. But let's do subdivide. Then we'd be able to select the sides. In theory, everything is mirroring, so everything will happen like this. Right? And there we have it. There we have the deck, and there we have the shape. Now to actually add the detail, yeah, I forgot that we would have it going higher, so the citadel would be going above, and I would not have had to delete those citadel parts, because that means I'll have to redo the whole thing again. But let's go on to adding some turrets, right? For that, we will select a box, cube, and make sure I remove grabbing. So I go in wireframe mode, I should be able to quickly adjust, scale Z, and then go to my vertices, grab Y, grab Z, grab Z again. I'm assuming that this little notch is going through the citadel itself, so I'm assuming the shape of the turret would go through this. So grab Y, and I think that it probably ends there, and then I do extrude, E for extrude. I don't know exactly where it ends, but I'll assume here. Do a shape like this, control R for loop cut, and then, well, this gets a little bit more dangerous. Let's cut that in half so that we don't repeat our work. Remove this side of the vertices. Tab, go to modifiers, do a mirror again. And then we have our little turret starting to take shape. So let's go in our wireframe view, grab X. So as you can see, I didn't quite estimate correctly where the front of the turret ends, and we can see that there is a little shape that's formed at the top. So we do grab Y, and I think that what's happening here, that the vertex is going like this, though there does seem to be another extra, does seem to be something, yeah, it's going on the side as well as on the top. This can be hard to copy sometimes. But I'm assuming adding a new loop cut here, and this would probably align. So I'll make it align, and then this bit looks like the turret is not. Once again, the plan might not be exactly accurate. We're getting the rough outline of it. I do think there's another spot here at the back where things change shape, but now I can't really tell what's going on, so I'll just remove that for now. This should be more inward, so let's do that. Let's get the basic shape down first. This is very strange to me. What you always want to do, though, is also add your subdivision surface. Now, I think why? And the reason is that when you're 3D printing something, for example, your vertices will show through as they're smooth, because Blender will triangulate things in the background and calculate the shadows accordingly. So it might show you something perfectly smooth, but then the geometry of it is not smooth. And when you put it inside a 3D printing software, it comes out to be crooked. I'm not sure the front is exactly made like this. I feel like the bend is on the edge here. That means this edge would be hard, but then this one is a soft edge, at least along the corner. And it looks like this. Okay. So this here would be what we're seeing. So this edge would be a hard edge. And then this would be going along the bottom. And this, it's my guess, would be going along the top here. This does seem to have some sort of hard edge, so I'm not sure exactly what's going on in this case. And since the bottom is completely flat, I don't necessarily need to make sure that my bottom parts are flat. So I'm guessing that this edge here would work by bringing it forward. It'll create the shape. I'm guessing it's something like this. So now if I have a look at it, it should make sense as a solid, right? And we can increase the subdivisions to at least 3. And then if we smooth the surface and make sure that our auto smooth is on, and this is where the degrees come into play. So if I reduce the number of degrees, then the requirement for something being sharp is less, so we can have sharper angles. I am not convinced that this shape is very accurate at the moment, but that's also because this needs to be flat most likely, and possibly this too. Now I'm just making all the edges sharp, which doesn't make any sense. Need to look at the ones that are really sharp. Really and truly sharp. This could be a bit curved. This one probably is not. And this is where it would help to have some reference photos, because I imagine these turrets are similar to a Richelieu class battleship, so that you would have the same appearance if you copied whatever is already available online. But for now, I'll leave it like that. And then we could add the cylinders. Now in this case, I would not necessarily subdivide. It would be quite useless, but let's just see how we would do this. So have a good amount of geometry is actually a good plan when you're going to 3D print stuff. For this, for a normal 3D print, would be fine. If it were for some sort of resin 3D printing, I'd pay even more attention to the geometry and maybe even subdivide this. We're going to grab. Now, I know that this is probably drawn flat, but from experience looking at turrets, they always have some sort of, I don't know if you call it like a camber or an enlargement along the back. So let's do that. And I made a mistake. Now the reason I had extra vertices there is that I had pressed extrude one more time than I needed to. Okay. And then here it's a cloth, so I don't want to go too much in detail doing that. But I will do shade smooth. If you wanted to, you could add a barrel inside. You just do this, and then extrude along the y-axis. Might end it there or something. Okay. And I still feel like the barrel would look smaller on the edge, on the tip. So I will just scale it a little bit inwards. I don't know if this is looking good or not, but it's roughly right. And once you have this perfectly done, you would go, see, we can see that it's completely inaccurate, but Alt-D will duplicate. You'll have exact copies, Alt-D again, which are linked to each other. So if I modify something, you can see it's modifying all of them, which would make sense in the case of a turret. Now, if you wanted to make this turret, let's add the cloths. I think for this, I would add a, sorry, shift A, add a cube, and I grab it, roughly do, nope, not render view, cube. Alright, scale it down, and then place the vertices so they're roughly aligned with the edges. And then probably we can go here and do extrude scale this. And then if I just do extrude again and rotate it a couple times and scale everything down, should come up with roughly the shape that's needed. For this, if I do alt and click, I should be able to select the edges and scale, grab, scale, rotate, grab, you know, all the good stuff. I don't know exactly how these are made. And then what I would expect to do is, that looks about right, so then I would go in my modifiers and do a subdiv. And if I do select all, shift E, I could harden it a little bit. Then we need a few subdivisions. I would say 4 is roughly correct. So, you know, you get the general idea, and then you could go sculpt this and change it and whatever needs to be done. I just think that this is a little bit incorrect. I think if I did scale X, maybe it would be like this. I don't know. I think that's more like what a battleship would be. And then use the same trick. So I do Alt D, X. Oh, and I have it too wide. So, well, actually, I don't need to delete it. If I do Alt D and X, you can adjust it on the spot, which is nice. So here, I would just go in and scale on the x-axis. Now it's kind of giving me more information on the size of it, but I don't really mind. I don't want to be so accurate right now. And when I just scale on the x-axis, well, it doesn't change the size of anything. So if I go back here, Alt X, there we go. This one should be smooth. And then, again, the same trick with auto smooth. This one is simply smooth because it's a cloth object. Then, I'll just do join. Yeah. The problem is that the modifiers are applied when you join. So it doesn't have a modifier in this one, and it removes it on the other one. If that made any sense. If you want to turn everything, I think you would do P, control P, set parent to object, yeah, and then I do R, Z, then it'll rotate with, same here, not join, but control P, object, rotate, and then you'll see everything rotate together, which is kind of nice. You know, you can make your own movie, and then I would probably add the deck afterwards. The way you do that is just the way you do anything else in Blender. Nope. Okay, so this is an interesting situation where we inaccurately moved something. I don't know whether it's happened on all times we did this. Select here, then what I do is press grab Z, but you'll notice that there's actually a double vertex, so I would do merge by distance at the end of that. Same thing here, and I would go check on the other side to see if I moved something there as well. Here it seems fine. So select all, merge by distance. Alright, so now I can select roughly shapes that are sort of flat to each other are good. In this case, what I would do is extrude along the x-axis here. Maybe extrude along the x-axis here. And then you can join everything together. Right. With F. everything gets joined in the middle. Like that. There we go. Now if I wanted to, let's do the back two. Here. Okay. And here. Everything. Okay. Now we have our decks back. But you'll notice that it's not as complex as it used to be, which makes selection a lot easier. But I did keep the crosswise kind of bulkhead style things. Alright. Let's move on to making the rudder. So for that, I would just use a cube. Go in wireframe mode. I like to scale in the object mode because it scales everything together with the vertex. Okay, this is a weird shape for a rudder, I'll be honest. What I would expect to do is, y-axis. Yeah, I would cut it vertically. I see that there would be a shape sort of like this one. Scale Z. And then here I see that it goes out like that. And then here. Oops. Here it would extrude somewhat like this. And I think this is part of the keel. But. For simplicity's sake, I'll just include it with the whole rudder assembly. Like that. And then all you'd have to do, scroll on the back, scale X, just like this. And if you wanted the rudder to have a shape that is sort of a hydrofoil shape, then I would enlarge it along the middle. Then it's just a simple matter of adding the subdivision surface and adding a few more. The more corners are along a subdivision surface, the more you'll want to subdivide them accurately. And then I'd just select the edges, the edge loops, as it were. So if I do shift, I can select many at once. Yeah, I'm not convinced about that. Okay. Let's select these. Select these. These. Select these. This could be a little bit scaled to create the corner effect. If we go in solid, we'll see it a bit better. At the same time, though, we are scaling this. Right. And this. If you have this situation, you need to add geometry. Here I did Control B to bevel, and it brings it a lot closer. Same thing here if you wanted to adjust the bevel. Control B. Okay, and I might even remove the hardening I did earlier, and you can see the nice pointed shape appears. And for even more realism, I would perhaps increase it a little bit. This side, if you wanted to, you could not do this, and instead you would hit Control B, do a bevel loop, and then you could kind of control how the whole thing bevels together. I think this is quite simple and probably would be close to this in real life. So I'll leave it like that for now, but if you were detailing this further, you know, you can play with that as much as you want. Now for this bit here, that's an interesting bit. It looks like it's part of the ship, and I think it should be designed that way as well. So the difficult part is when you have tricky geometry like that. Not great. So could be designed as a separate part, like the rudder itself, and added as a separate element later. I am not sure. You could spend a lot of time going in here and playing with the, you know, adding a loop cut and then extruding it and adding vertices and fiddling around. I'm not going to do too much of that because I don't want to get caught up in many of the details so far. Now let's try it for a bit of superstructure. As with the rest, the general idea is to block things in. I see here the superstructure has a very clear shape. Move the heater. Alright, very clear shape that we can see from the top. And in this case, it is completely square, so I don't need to add a subdiv modifier. I just need to make sure that the corners fit with the area. So if I bring the corner close to the edge, and then it'll snap properly. I guess there's no and in that. It'll just snap correctly. Because I like this design because the superstructure is going to be easy to separate from the body of the hull of the ship. In some other ships, like modern stealth designs, there's a lot more of the hull and superstructure running together, which makes it a little difficult. So I will mirror my work right away to avoid having to double my work. So as always, choose mirror, and then add clipping. And then out here, I'd grab it. The only problem would come if the edge weren't straight, but in this case it is straight. So I'll do a grab along the x-axis. You can see it's not quite what I was expecting. And that could be because the vertices are not the ones I wanted. So if I select the edge, yeah, there's locking to the correct edge. Now shift tab to remove that, grab Y, go forward, and grab Y, and this one I think I can add a loop cut here, and then scale Y, you know, could do it multiple ways, but seems convenient. Ideally I would want this part and this part to align, but it looks like they're the front one is less wide, so I'll scale X and then grab Y. It's roughly correct. Grab Y again. Extrude Y. Scale X. As you see, when I scale X, it'll only scale inwards because the clipping is on, which kind of locks that vertex into place. Okay? So we should see our superstructure coming along. For whatever reason, we didn't, probably didn't select the corner there, so let me just redemonstrate this. When I selected here, I selected only the two edges, but if we were to extrude the whole thing, we need to select all of it. There we go. Now let's go build our superstructure. Extrude Y, Y, scale X, there we go. And you'll notice I'm always choosing a direction to scale in, because otherwise it would scale in every direction. That would not be clean. Extrude Y, and then extrude Y again. And I think that this goes into the turret, but this time we don't need to join the geometries. In fact, it would be optional. You could, instead of doing what I did and join the geometries, like here, what you probably end up doing because of the problems this is creating is, in fact, omit this, cut the superstructure here, and since the citadel is a separate part anyway, you just add it separately. So let me demonstrate what it looks like, actually. This is kind of, you know, you make errors when you work and then you realize what you did. Okay. I'm having a duplicate somewhere, and that's slightly sad. I don't know why this is crossing to the other side. I thought that the clipping was preventing us from doing this. Let's see, if I hide it, that's so weird. Why'd it let me do that? I don't want to do that. Probably because we added the that part separately. So, as I said before, we would be adding the turret citadel separately. And in this case, what you would do is come on top of here and wireframe, then add a cylinder and just make it a separate part. Probably what I should have done at first. Keeps things a lot. Well, I'm not sure how all the geometry will help me, but at the same time, it's not going to hurt me. So, watch it hurt me later. Okay. Oh boy. For some reason, it's not letting me snap to what I want to snap. So, let's get closer to what I need to snap to. Scale out here. Okay. This is a little inaccurate, so I'm going to fix it. Oh, my snapping is off. Fabix. Okay, there we go. Now we're exactly on top of what we need. We just need to have this there. This there. And now what I can do is fit it correctly. Here we are, there we go. Okay. And if I do smooth, no. Smooth, it'll shade it very weirdly. And then we do auto smooth, and that corrects it. In my opinion, this should be a default. It would be a smart default to have. I don't know why it's not a default, but I didn't make the program. I would assume that this should be done as well here. Seeing how the mirror didn't work too well. Okay, we do shoot X. That. Okay, then we can do Shift D. And Y, and place this. Ah, we have the same size difference here, so I'm just going to move it in. I want to grab vertex, yep, and then grab Y. Allow me to be exactly placed. There we go. Ah, vertical view is completely different from, well, a little different. I did get it. Admit to our errors. Seems like this one is not ending at precisely the same spot. So I'll scale it inwards just a little bit. There we go. Now this is not quite right. Why has it changed the level though? Isn't this exactly level? Ooh. A little bit off, huh? So let's bring it back down. That's strange. Oh well. I'll have to figure it out later. For right now. There's something very interesting that you can do for these turrets. If I select everything, I can't join it, remember, but I can do something that's called new collection, call it turret, and then if we hit M, we should move it to turret, and
reflect everything.
Oh, okay, I see. Yep. Should be. So, yeah, okay. Okay. So if I do duplicate. Okay, instance to scene. We'll create a new instance of a collection to scene, which you can't really edit, but it's useful for copying something inside a collection. And often those are items that you can't really put together but go together. So, do it again. Instance to scene, grab Y, rotate Z 180. Woohoo. Yeah, this is one thing I don't like. It causes the origin to go at the center of the world, but it doesn't really make sense for what you're putting inside. Okay, anyway. I guess it would be a main gun turret or something like that. I'll just place it roughly like this. And this allows us to get a general image of what we're building. Okay. We have our superstructure. Superstructures are challenging to build, to say the least. Because they have these very weird shapes. So, you have to look at what you want to do first and where you want to put your efforts. I will block out a little bit, at the risk of obscuring a little bit of my design as well. So if I do grab Y, I think it looks like this is a tower in its own right, kind of-ish. Looks like there's a cut here, that this scales a little bit inwards, and continues towards the top. But then there's something else that happens here, which is weird. And once again, this is where photo reference would help. I'm not using it right now because I'm not super interested in being very accurate. I don't know if this superstructure is actually a second level, but this gives a rough idea. And because these elements here are rangefinders, I happen to know what they are. I do know that they would be copied over. So because of that, I would work a bit like I did with the turrets, to where I would keep one and then duplicate it around, which saves a lot of work and makes your work a lot more accurate as well. Okay. Now I do think we forgot something on the hull. And that is, we missed the loop cut here. That'll solve a couple of problems. Ooh. But see, what happens now is that, and this is something that's peculiar to Blender, and which is really kind of annoying, but there's nothing much to do about it. I don't know why it happens. But, yeah. It, unfortunately, does not. When you change some of the geometry, especially deleting stuff and adding subdivisions, it will not allow the loop cuts to continue across as they should. Regardless, I'll just grab this element and bring it back about here. That should give us a more accurate shape for the front. And it should also, yeah, more or less more accurate shape. So I would play with the vertices more carefully, follow a curve that is pleasant to the eye. And what you can do at the front is sometimes if something is looking above something else, you would maybe go a bit sharper like that. Pretty good to me. I do want to start with the chimney as well. For this same trick, I'm sorry. Grab Y. Grab Y. And again, don't go detailed at first, but rather block out what needs to be made. In this instance, I can't really tell what's going on behind here. But I'm assuming it goes something like that. Then like this, then like that, sort of kind of. There we go. Whoops. This I would delete. Parentheses. And to avoid duplicating what I'm doing twice, it would be nice if there were kind of a mirror add-on, I don't know, to be able to do this all in one shot, but it's not very hard. Just name clipping. Then I go here. F. There we go. Now we've got our superstructure. With these complex shapes, what I would do is create a new item for the top. So, cube. Scale that. Grab Z. Grab Y. Grab Y. And then grab Z. And once again, we're on the rangefinders, so I would kind of wait and see what to do about that one. I do suspect that these edges are rounded, but I'd have to reference material to be able to tell exactly what's going on here. And there we go. We have a rough sketch of a battleship. I would add a cube here on top to get the scale of the height. Do that really fast. As you can see, I'm moving in and out of edit mode so that I avoid moving the origin. I want the origin to be centered, ideally. I can do Shift D if I want to copy that item. In this case, I know it's already aligned, so it saves me some work. The reason I have to go in wireframe mode is because you won't see anything unless you won't select the back face vertices unless you are in wireframe mode. Okay, so this sketches out the height. And then the rest is a bunch of detailing and paying attention and tweaking and so on. I guess we could add the glacis here for this, or glacis. I don't know what it's called in English. So, look at that. There's slight inaccuracy. So you can just go here or here and correct this. The glacis. I think it'd go with a plane. Rotate 90. And then what I would do is cut it immediately in half. That was not half. Okay, there we go. And go in wireframe view. Do the vertices there. Doing this again. Doing a mirror, and then going to the top, so grab Y, then we'd want this to be at the correct height, and then we would be able to move it backwards. This, we could move here. That gets a rough shape out of the way. For the rest, it's just a matter of fitting it to the hull. I do notice that here the hull is not exactly the right shape, and that's probably because we selected this. And there we go. So by adjusting it here, we can get it to fit. Obviously that's too high. Bring it down. And I'm kind of having to guess what the correct length is, because as we know, the front and side view are not super accurate to one another. What I do here in this case to solidify it is use the solidify modifier. So if we go and add a modifier again, and solidify, and I always like to use the complex mode. And I think even gives the best results. It depends on the sort of work that you're doing. There you go. Kind of like this. Then afterwards, it's just a question of adding these additional details. It does look like the drawing doesn't quite give the same shape as the side view. In fact, it gives the opposite shape, which is very interesting. This one would go here, and this one would go there. That looks a little bit more correct, though. Okay. So that's that. So then I won't add the braces, but we could do that. Well, the trick with this is to wait as long as possible before converting the hull to a hard design where you can add booleans. And that's just that if you have edits to the hull, you don't have a ton of small vertices to modify. But eventually, and I'll use this to demonstrate, what you'd want to do is 3D print it. And to 3D print it, what I would suggest, first of all, apply your modifiers, assuming that everything is working great. You will end up with a hull like this then. This may or may not be accurate enough. You could increase the size of the subdivide so that you have more vertices. But regardless, you will select plane, and then rotate that on the x-axis 90 degrees, grab y, and then you start using the boolean modifier to cut this ship into bits. Now what I've been thinking is, you would do best to use a shape, something like this for example, something very simple, where you could extrude some of the faces. I maybe should have more than that. That looks about right. Oops. Put like this, and make a corrugation. Something like that. And that would assume removing the edges here. Okay. So with this corrugated shape, what you can do is first solidify it, complex, well, simple should work, and an even thickness, yep, that works very well, and you want it to be a very thin 0.001, let's say. Of course, you'd want to first scale your model to the right size. Okay, and using this shape, we would be able to use the boolean modifier. So, take our ship, do boolean, select this shape, and apply. And then what you'd have is two separate sections. If I do Control L, I can separate this, and P, select the selection, and then you'd have a separate object. The advantage of this is that you can, if you glue these two items together when you're 3D printing, you'll have an exact fit, you know, and you won't need to adjust anything. And it'll be a lot stronger as well because the bond will be made throughout. Now, there's one detail that you want to take care of, and that's making sure that your hull has a certain thickness. Usually, you would not want to fill the hull with complete plastic. So to do this, let's apply our modifiers, simply that way, I guess. Actually, no. We can do it with a mod. So you do solidify. Complex mode. But then you realize that there are quite a few problems. Yeah. Thickness modes would be even, I think. So this is when you, it's very annoying. The blender's thickness modifier is not great, and it does cause some issues. But I think if I won't play with it right now, I'll wait till another time. So that's roughly how you construct a boat, and in the future I'll probably show the process of how I, or maybe just a speed video of how I managed to create this boat and prepare it for 3D printing. But for right now, that's it, and I hope that's helpful.